Bonjour tout le monde et bienvenue à ce séminaire qui sera présenté par Maxime Rouaud qui est aux États-Unis actuellement. Donc, il a fait sa thèse au lab avec, tu as travaillé avec Valentine, n'est-ce pas?
Ah oui, c'est ça.
Oui, donc, et ensuite, après sa thèse, il est parti au NASA Ames aux États-Unis. Et il va nous présenter ses résultats sur la physique et la chimie des disques. Donc, on est très curieux de voir tes nouveaux résultats. Donc, vas-y, tu peux commencer.
Bah, merci beaucoup, Timéa. J'ai décidé de faire mon séminaire en anglais, donc je vais switcher en anglais. Mais d'abord, je voulais dire que c'est un grand plaisir de présenter mes résultats à Bordeaux. Ça, c'est toujours... sympa. Bon, j'aurais bien voulu être là en présentiel. J'espère que d'ici quelques mois, ce sera possible. On verra bien comment ça évolue. So, yeah, so the goal of this talk will be to show you some of the recent results I have been obtaining on the study of the physics and chemistry of protoplanetary disks. So I will focus on theoretical results or modeling results. From a framework I have been developing in collaboration with Uma Gorti at NASA Ames, whose goal is to develop a model able to interpret the observations in protoplanetary disks, which require some detailed modeling, as you will see soon, but also to give some constraints on the physics and chemistry induced by planet formation and how it impacts the chemistry of protoplanetary disks. So as you probably already know, protoplanetary disks are complex objects which are characterized by strong gradients of temperature, density, and radiation, which all have an important impact on both the vertical and radial physics of the structure of the protoplanetary disks. So we also have some important processes of evolution and transport of dust, shown here on the left-hand side of the figure, whose most direct signature is the planet formation process. So when we talk about chemistry in disks, we usually distinguish between three main regions, shown here on the right, a region in red here called the PDR layer or the atomic layer, where UV and X-ray radiation from the stellar from the central star. Directly ionize the medium, and so we mainly have atoms and ions in this region, and so the chemistry is dominated by photoprocessing. When we go a little bit deeper and farther from the star, we enter what we call the molecular layer, shown here in yellow, where we have some important transitions and one chemical transition, and the most important one is that we go from fully atomic gas to fully molecular gas because of efficient shielding. And in particular, we have the H to H2 transition and also the C plus to CO transition. So this region is characterized by a complex gas phase chemistry. And as we go a little bit deeper into the disk, we enter the so-called midplane of the disk, where the physical conditions are such that most of the molecules will deplete at the surface of the grains and start a complex grain surface chemistry. So with the formation of ices. So this region is also characterized by several evaporation fronts, the so-called snow lines in disks, with increasing temperature as we get closer to the star. So instruments like ALMA and NOEMA have completely revolutionized our understanding of or at least the view we have on protoplanetary disks, because by giving us access to the smaller scales of those objects, they allow us to study in detail the physics and chemistry of those disks. So here I'm showing like some of the results, spectacular results obtained from a D-Sharp large program on ALMA, where which shows like the thermal emission from millimeter dust in 20 disks that has been observed at 1.2 millimeter with a very, very high resolution. And so you can see that you have a lot of different structures. You have gap and rings. In some cases, you even have spiral arms or arc-like features. And all there's observations give us a lot of constraints, and in particular on the planet formation process, because we think that we have planet formation, ongoing planet formation in those objects. Similar structures are, at least for gaps and rings, are also seen in molecules. So this is illustrated here for several molecules in different disks. And so you see that the molecular emission observed for some of the molecules like C2H, DCO plus or N2H plus show ring-like structures, while other molecules like C18O and CS have a more centrally peaked emission. And so this also gives us some important constraints on the chemistry in those objects. However, what's quite amazing is that even though we now have all this data, we are still struggling with some very fundamental questions. And one of the main questions we are still trying to understand is the question of determination of disk mass, which is still open, but yet fundamental for understanding several aspects of this. So the first one is to understand disk dynamics. For instance, how we go from the protoplanetary disk phase, which contains like roughly 99% of gas and 1% of dust, at least at the beginning, when it forms, to the debris disk phase, where most of the gas has been removed from the system and only the dust is left over. It is also very important to understand planet disk interaction. For instance, how planets migrate in disks, and of course, one of the main questions is to understand planet formation, because the mass of these disks will have a strong impact on planet formation. So for the dust, we have a pretty good understanding. We have some good constraints on the dust mass, mostly because it's relatively easy, and both theoretically to derive dust masses, but also with observations, because it doesn't require a lot of time to get data. And so if you consider that the emission, the continuum emission is optically thin, which is roughly the case at a millimeter wavelength, then you have a direct relationship between the flux, the continuum flux you observe at millimeter wavelength, with the mass, the total mass of the dust contained in the disk. So of course, you need some important physical parameters such as the opacity of the dust, so which depends on the grain composition, the size distribution of the dust, and which actually carries most of the uncertainties. We estimate that this factor is uncertain by a factor of 10, which makes that the mass determination is uncertain by a factor of 10. You also need some estimate of the dust temperature as well as the distance from the source. But that's something you can easily get. So by doing this, people have been able to do some statistics and infer dust masses in several star forming regions. So this is shown here for different surveys in different star forming regions, where you see like the inferred dust mass as a function of the mass of the central star in the Taurus, Lepus, and other star-forming regions. And by doing so, people have been able to infer some trends, and in particular, some kind of steepening of the relation M dust, M star with age, which actually gives us some information on the evolution of the dust in disks. So for the gas, determining the gas mass turns out to be much more challenging than the dust. We could think at first, okay, we are able to determine the dust mass we are able to get some constraints for the dust mass. So why don't we use like a gas to dust ratio as we have in the interstellar medium, like roughly 100, and multiply that by the dust mass and get the gas mass. As I already said, dust and gas, we know that, at least for debris disk, we know that there is a decoupling, and that and dust and gas may evolve differently, so you don't really want to do that. You would prefer to have independent measurement of the gas mass. The second option would be to use H2, which is the main molecular compound in disks. However, due to its symmetry, H2 doesn't have a permanent dipole moment, and so it's not emissive in cold regions. This problem is gone when you use HD, for which we got some data with Herschel. However, there is no current facilities for observing HD in disks. And so what people use is CO, it's isotope log, which are easily observed at millimeter wavelength. But we know that CO has a complex distribution in disk, and in general, you need you always need a modeling to go from observed flux to inferred gas mass. And so this is illustrated here, where I show like the CO abundance map in the gas phase as a function of the distance from the star and the altitude in the disk. And so you see that basically CO is abundant between two boundaries set by photodissociation in the upper layers of the disk and freeze out in the midplane. So basically you need a model that is able to take into account these two boundaries to get the CO distribution and then go to infer the gas mass. So by using pretty simple models, people have been able to run like a grid of models where they vary several these parameters, and in particular the gas mass. So you see here the results of such models. So 13 CO, the 13 CO 322 line and the C18O 322 line computed with different models on the different gas mass. So each point here in color represents a model. And then by putting your observations on this kind of on this kind of plot, you can basically read the mass of the gas mass of the mass of the gas in your disk. So by doing so, people have been able to also infer some other quantities, such as the gas to dust ratio. So this is illustrated here in the LAPES. So this is a survey that has been carried out by Ansdell et al. 2016. So by observing the continuum emission of the dust, they could get dust masses, the estimated gas masses from CO isotopologues, and then by doing the ratio, they could estimate the gas to dust ratio. In this survey, but also in other surveys, they have found in general gas to dust ratio which has much lower than what we have in the interstellar medium, for which we have a value of 100 by a factor of 10 to 100. They also find, as you can see here, a gradient. So this is here, the x-axis is different disks, basically. And so they could find a gradient in the dust to gas mass ratio. So there is a lot of debate on this. I will come back to this a little bit later, but basically this can be interpreted into three ways. The first one is that the inferred ratio truly reflects a decoupling between gas and dust, and in which case you need to understand what causes this decrease in the gas to dust ratio and also the gradient you observe. The second option would be that we don't really understand the CO distribution in disks, and that other processes may affect the CO distribution in disk. And a third way is relatively linked to the second one, but you will see it's a bit different. That model, the model used to estimate gas masses, is too simple and simply does not capture well the underlying physics and chemistry. So basically, you need additional constraints. So we did get additional constraints from HD in a few disks. And in particular, in a very famous object, which is TW Hydra, which is an orbital disk at, located at 60 AU from the sun, which is for which we have a lot of observation at all wavelengths, making this disk one of the best to date objects. But it turns out that gas mass estimate from CO and HD in this disk vary by more than two orders of magnitude, which means that if you want to compute the gas to dust ratio, because we have a pretty good understanding of the dust mass in this disk, you get a value of 0.7 when you use CO and around 70 when using HD, so very close to what we have in the interstellar medium, knowing that this disk is pretty old. We estimate that it is a 10 million years old disk. So given that HD chemistry is pretty simple, and we think that we understand relatively well HD distribution in the disk, people have invoked the fact that CO, the ratio CO over H2, could be lower by a factor of 10 to 100 compared to what we have in the interstellar medium, for which we have values around 10 to minus 4. And so you need to find a way, a scenario that is able to decrease, globally decrease the CO abundance in the disk by a factor of 10 to 100. So scenarios coupling grain chemistry and dust evolution have been proposed. And so basically the idea here is that you freeze out CO at the surface of small grains that will evolve, get bigger, grow, coagulate, settle into the disk midplane, eventually grow further to lead to the formation of planetesimals. And basically you will remove CO from the system. So dust evolution will act as a sink. And basically, as a function of time, this will decrease the amount of CO you have in the gas phase. So this scenario had some echo in the community, because it proposes a direct link between disk chemistry and planet formation process. So we also have other constraints from other molecules like CN, HCN, small carbon chains, which also seem to indicate changes compared to the interstellar medium, and in particular on the elemental C over O ratio, for which you require enhanced elemental C over O ratio when you want to understand when you want to reproduce the observed emission of these molecules. So this is illustrated here for C2H and C3H2 in TW Hydra, which actually also show a very beautiful ring-like structure. And so there are currently two ways, two scenarios for explaining this. The first one is based on the carbon addition in the at the surface of the disk by photodestruction of carbon grains. So this is something that has been invoked also in the interstellar medium for explaining C2H emission in the Oort-Cyan nebula. But we are still waiting for reaction rate that we could use, photodestruction rate we could use in models from experimentalist. And a second scenario, which is the same as the one before, a coupling between grain chemistry and dust evolution, that would preferentially decrease the oxygen from the gas phase, for instance, through the formation of water ice, and enhanced the C over O ratio in the gas phase over O ratio in the disk. So if we want to summarize the current paradigm, so that's something I will be questioning a lot after, but still. So we have grain surface chemistry with dust evolution that can deplete volatiles. So this leads to a decrease of the gas phase over CO over H2 ratio. And also we would like to have oxygen to be more depleted than carbon to enhance the C over O ratio, the gas phase over O ratio. We could also have volatile carbon that can be added to the system by photodestruction of small grains, and the resulting effect is that the decrease in the CO over H2 ratio could explain the apparent disconnect in gas mass inferences from CO and HD, and a higher enhanced CO over ratio could favor the formation of molecules like C2H, CN, and HCN. So there are, of course, some important limitations to this scenario. The first one is that direct observational probes are very difficult to get, so which makes this entire scenario very speculative at the moment. This also the fact that this scenario is based on results obtained from models that in most of the cases are relatively simple and make strong approximation on the physical structure of the disk. But we know that physics and chemistry are strongly coupled in disk, and so you need to use full thermochemical models to interpret these observations. And also, something that we should keep in mind is that species such as CN and C2H or order of magnitude lower than the bulk abundance of their constituent elements, which means that if you want to make to infer changes in in elemental C over O ratio, you are required to have a very good understanding of their chemistry. However, there are some important chemical pathways are currently missing or not well understood. So the objective here of this talk will be to revisit this scenario with newer sophisticated thermochemical disk model. And so I will discuss two main problems, which is the mass problem I have introduced you. And a second thing that I have been working on recently, which is the introduction of state-to-state chemistry with excited H2. And you will see that this will have an impact for this last point here on important chemical pathways that are missing for the formation of a molecule like CN and C2H for inferring changes in C over O ratio. So first, let me introduce the model we are using, the framework we are using. So the first thing we do is that we solve for the 2D structure of the disk by using a thermochemical model, which compute the equilibrium disk structure. So by solving the relative transfer, gas phase chemistry, and thermal balance. Then this structure is used to compute time-dependent gas grain chemistry. So this is the model I have developed during my PhD in Bordeaux. And then with output of this model, we can produce synthetic observation maps that can be directly compared to observations. So the thermochemical disk model iteratively solve for the vertical hydrostatic equilibrium. So heating include dust collisions, impact of X-rays and UV, as well as chemical reactions. So you have here different heating terms as a function of the altitude in the disk. I think it's at 5 AU from the star. Cooling include atomic and molecular emission lines. It is mostly dominated by atomic and molecular emission lines. And gas phase chemistry includes ion neutral, neutral, and photoreactions. So after a few iterations, you can get the 2D structure of the disk for the density and the temperature. And so here I show a typical temperature map as a function of the distance from the star and the altitude in the disk. So then this structure can be used to compute time-dependent gas grain chemistry. So where I use the model I developed during my PhD. So I solve for the accretion of the molecule at the surface of the grains, how these molecules diffuse at the surface, meet, and eventually react to form more complex ones. I also take into account surface and subsurface photoprocessing by stellar, interstellar, and cosmic rays generated photons and several desorption mechanisms to desorb these molecules to the gas phase. So this includes thermal and non-thermal desorption mechanisms, including chemical desorption and photodesorption. So here is just one example showing you the typical structure and composition of one disk. So this is for a disk orbiting a sun-like star. So you have here on the left-hand side the structure computed from the thermochemical disk model. So you have the density map, the gas phase, the temperature of the gas, temperature of the dust, and here the local UV field in the disk, so in terms of G0, where G0 equal to 1, or log G0 equal to 0, is the interstellar radiation field. Same flux as the interstellar radiation field. On the left-hand side, you have the predicted abundance maps for some important molecules like H2, C+, C+U, and water ice. And so you can see that you have some important transition here, as I already discussed. So you have the transition between the atomic layer and the molecular layer. So you transition from a fully atomic to fully molecular gas. So H transition to H2 and C+ transition to CO. So CO becomes abundant in the molecular layer. And then you have a second transition, which is the water condensation front, or where, like when you enter the midplane, CO freezes out at the surface of the grains and water ice efficiently form in the midplane. So here are some other examples for other molecules that are commonly observed in disks. And so actually, one of the main conclusions of our paper we published in 2019, where we present the framework, was to show that actually millimeter and submillimeter observations in disks trace many two regions. First region is the interface between the molecular layer and the atomic layer and the molecular layer. So you see here that you have an abundance of molecules like C2H and CN. And a second region, which is at the interface between the molecular layer and the midplane, which actually traces the vertical water condensation front, where you efficiently form molecules like CS, water, gas phase water, formaldehyde, and methanol. And all these molecules are affected by somehow affected by grain surface chemistry. For other molecules like C2H and CN, you see that we predict a two-layered structure where these molecules can originate both in the PR layer and near the water condensation front. So now I would like to come back to the mass problem I have introduced you earlier. So I hope to have convinced you that this is a very fundamental problem for understanding disk evolution and planet formation processes. That people use CO and its isotopologues to get the gas mass, which are easily observed, but which have CO as a complex distribution in the disk, so you require modeling in order to go from observed flux to gas mass. And in particular, you need some key ingredients for your modeling for treating the boundary between the atomic layer and the molecular layer, where CO photodissociate, you need to take into account self and mutual shielding for CO, as well as isotope selective processes. So basically how photodissociation varies, changes with different isotopes. And also for the boundary in the midplane, you need like a complete grain surface gas grain model, which treat for the balance between accretion and desorption at the surface of the grains and chemical processing in the ice. So what we have done here, and so this is a publication in preparation, what we have done here was to simply repeat what people have done, but using a self-consistent model. So to run a disparameter survey, which includes all the mechanisms I have discussed earlier, and take into account chemistry for deuterium, 13C, and 18O. So basically, we have explored a few parameters because all those models take a lot of time to run. Each model takes roughly a week. So for the gas disk mass, we have explored five different gas disk mass varying from 3 × 10⁻⁴ to 0.1 solar masses. We have explored three values for the gas to dust mass ratio of 10, 100, and 1000, where 100 corresponds to the interstellar medium. And one case where we have varied the disk radius, so a compact disk and a more extended disk. So we have in total like 24 models. And so here I'm showing the the result for one disk, typical disk. So you here you have like the computed density for HD, 12CO, 13CO, and C18O in the gas phase. And below you have the normalized emission map for molecule like for emission of HD120, 12CO322, and 13CO322, and C18O322. So basically, you can see where most of the emission originate in the disk. So what you can see from this plot first is that using different tracers, traces different region in the disk, you see that molecule like 12CO mainly traces the upper region of the disk. And this is because 12CO quickly turn optically thick. So it quickly turn optically thick. So you are not tracing very efficiently the deeper layers, while other isotopologues like 13CO and C18O are able to go deeper. And in particular, C18O traces like regions very close to the midplane. So then, by running all these models, you can look at some trends. So here I'm showing the line luminosities for the same transitions as a function of the gas mass of each disk, and where different colors show results obtained for the different gas to dust mass ratio, and the case where we have a smaller disk of 100 AU. So here, each point corresponds to one model. So I will not enter into the details of this figure, but what you can see is that molecule like 12CO and 13CO will not do a great job at tracing the gas mass of disks, because you see that the emission tend to flatten as the gas mass increases. And this is due to the fact that there's a transition become optically thick when the gas mass increases. And so you are mainly sensitive to the temperature at some point. You can also see that on the opposite, that HD and C18O correlate pretty well, even though it's not fully linear, with the gas mass, making this molecule a relatively good tracer of the gas mass. You see also that C18O for the low gas to dust mass ratio of 10, the curve tend to flatten, which actually show that there is also some dependence of the C18O emission on the structure for the physical structure for the dust. So then you can ask yourself some fundamental questions. And one of the fundamental one that is relevant for future missions like SPICA and the Origin Space Telescope is HD a better tracer than CO? We know that most of the mass reside in the disk midplane, where the densities are high, but where CO freezes out at the surface of the grain, which means that CO only traces a small fraction of the mass. So using this argument, some people have argued that HD, because HD doesn't freeze out at the surface of the grain because of its low binding energy, HD should be a better tracer of the gas mass of disk. And we actually show that this is not true. And this is because HD emission is very sensitive to the gas temperature. So here I'm showing the expression that link the observed flux for the HD120 transition to the gas mass. And you see that at the denominator, you have a factor that is the fractional population in the upper state of HD. And for the 120 transition, this factor has an exponential that varies with 1 minus 30, 1 30 over T. which makes that actually HD is very sensitive to the gas temperature and is emissive only in warm region. And so this is what we show here for HD120. You see that there is no emission coming from the mid plane, which is relatively cold. And so in fact, we show that HD and C18O actually do a pretty similar job at tracing the gas mass of the disk, and that HD is not any better than C18O. Then we could compare also with observations. So here I'm showing the computed 13 CO 322 emission as a function of the dust mass here. It's not the quantity that is available to observations. And the C18O 322, so for all the different models. And I have overplotted here, I have added like the observations in the lupus. So for C18O and 13CO, so we have some constraints of the dust mass and the observed flux for C18O and 13CO. And so what you can see is that our results suggest that most of the disks in the lupus are consistent with gas to dust ratio of 100, which is shown here by the blue curve here, which is in strong disagreement with what was found previously, if you remember, where people have inferred a factor of 10 to 100 decrease in the gas to dust ratio for in this region. And also, we find that large-scale depletion of CO is not required to explain CO observation in these disks. And because we used ISM values for the initial abundance. And actually, we find that all the differences with other studies can be explained by differences in the level of details included in these models. So here, I'm showing one example, sensitized synthetic emission maps for C18O 322 in three cases, two cases which corresponds to a model found in the literature that were used basically for infer to model disk in the lupus, and the model we have, so a self-consistent model. So in this model here on the left hand side, basically they have assumed a parametric density structure, ignore the isotope selective process, and there is no grain surface chemistry. And so you can see that you can have almost a factor of 10 for this disk for on the complete emission map. And this actually shows you that detailed models are critical for decoding molecular emission lines, for molecular emission in disks. So now I would like to transition to the chemistry with a raw vibrationally excited H2. So this is a process that is known to play an important role in the chemistry of PDRs, of interstellar PDRs, for a long time now. It has been proposed by Agundes, Marcelino Agundes, in 2010. And we know that it helps overcoming some important reaction barriers. So I'm showing here the example of C++ H2, the reaction with C++ H2, which leads to the formation of CH+, an important ion in the interstellar medium. So this reaction with ground state H2 has a barrier of roughly 5,000 K. But you can see here that the reaction rate for this reaction at low temperature, even more critical at low temperature, can be increased by several orders of magnitude when it reacts with excited H2. So you have here the different level of excitation of H2, and basically you can see that when the H2 is in V equal to 1 state, so first vibrational state, then the reaction becomes barrierless. This is here also one example showing the effect of this reaction on the model of the Orion bar, where you see that the abundance of CH+ is increased by several orders of magnitude, at least 2 to 3, in the PDR layer, so near the transition between H and H2, so at the edge of the PDR. And this is due to the to this reaction with excited H2. So the process by which H2 excitation works is quite complicated, but in disks and PDR, what dominates the excitation is FUV pumping. So basically, FUV photons get absorbed by H2 in its ground vibrational state in the Lyman and Werder bond, which pumps H2 into its excited electronic state. You have approximately 10% of this electronic excited state that de-excite to the continuum, and which lead to the dissociation of the molecule, and approximately 90% which de-excite to bond rotational levels of ground electronic state, which lead to an infrared cascade that is actually observable in the infrared from 1 to 30 microns, and for which we will have a lot of constraints with GWST. So in disks, what people have done so far, they have assumed like the so-called two-level approximation that was proposed by Chelence and Hollenbach in 1995 to model the dissociation of H2. So it works pretty well for the dissociation of H2. But then people have started to take this into account for taking into account the chemistry with excited H2. So the way it works is that the complicated cascade here is approximated by only two levels, where they introduce like a pseudo level V equal to and corresponding to a V equal to 6 state, which has an energy of 30,000 K that is so large that basically there is no collisional excitation that can occur, so which makes the entire process much easier to treat. And then what people have done, so you pump from V equal to zero to the electronic excited state, you still have 10% that goes to the continuum, 90% that goes back to the V equal to six, and the V equal to six state directly de-excites the V equal to zero state. And so then people have assumed that reactions having a barrier that is lower than 30,000 K basically could proceed as if there was no barrier. So using this approximation, some people have been able to explain CN emission in TDB Hydra by assuming no barrier for the reaction for N plus H2. And so you have here an example, which is like the abundance of several molecules as a function of the altitude in the disk. So I don't really remember where it is which radius, but basically you see that the abundance of CN is pretty high near the PDR layer where excited H2 is abundant, and this is because they assume that N plus H2 becomes barrierless. However, we know from the PDR studies that chemistry with excited H2 strongly depends on the level population in each rotational state, and that you need detailed calculations. So that's what I have done. I have included this detailed modeling for excitation of H2, which takes into account all important processes, collisional processes, FUV pumping, X-ray excitation, and excitation at formation and orthopower conversion in grains. I have for the chemistry, we have some data as a function of the different excited level of H2 for C plus, S plus, and O that were obtained either through experiments or quantum calculations. And for other reactions, I have simply assumed that whenever the energy of the so the reaction of the barrier decreases with increasing the energy of the level of H2, and whenever the energy of the level of H2 is higher than the reaction barrier, then everything proceeds as if there was no barrier. So this works pretty well for instance when you compare with the data for C+, but we know that for other reactions it's not a very good approximation, but this is something that we'll need to more data. So here I'm showing like the computed abundance map for several excited levels of H2. So all the H2 in the ground vibrational state and for different rotational state of H2 up to v j equal to 8, and then for v equal to 1, v equal to 2, v equal to 3, etc. So what you can see is that chemistry with excited H2 will mainly have will mainly be important in the PER layer, where FUV pumping is actually important, and so where FUV photons are efficiently absorbed by H2, which pumps H2 in its excited states. So here are the results. So I'm showing I have considered three models. One model where I do not account chemistry with excited H2. One model where I have assumed the two-level approximation that is commonly used in disks. And one model where I have the full model, so detailed calculation for H2 excitation. So here I'm showing the results for three molecules, C2H, CN, and HN in these three models. And so basically, you can see that chemistry with excited H2 has a very, very important impact on molecules like CN and HCN, whose abundances are increased by almost 2 to 3 orders of magnitude in the PER layer. I also find that the two-level approximation that is commonly used actually overestimate CN and HCN by a factor of 10 roughly when you compare with a full model, and that is because you need to have a detailed calculation of H2 excitation. And as you can imagine, this is critical based on what I have discussed before, because these molecules are used to infer change in elemental ratios. And so depending on whether the conclusion you draw on the change in elemental abundances ratio. So here are my conclusions. So I hope to have convinced you that interpreting molecular observations in disks is a complex process where the use of detailed models is required. As you have seen, the level of details used in models profoundly impacts the conclusion drawn from observations. In particular, I have showed you that disk in Lupus seems to have gas redox ratios similar to interstellar medium, to what we have in the ISM. CO depletion is not required to reconcile the apparent disconnect between gas reactions based on CO and HD. And finally, I have showed you that chemistry with excited H2 impacts molecules like CN and HCN, which are used to infer changes in CO ratios. So actually, these results lead to some very interesting and fundamental questions for which I don't have any answer yet. In particular, we know that gas and dust evolve in disks, at least through dust evolution, planet formation, photoevaporation. And so one very fundamental question is what could keep the gas to dust ratio close to its initial value. So this actually suggests that there could be some self-regulation processes, but I don't know. That's something that will need more investigation. And also, what is the impact of a constant gas to dust ratio on the planet formation process? At least it suggests that giant planets are, it's relatively easy to form giant planets because you have a lot of gas around. So I thank you for your attention. I will take your questions.
Thank you, Maxime. This has been a really exciting a journey to the world of disks and your work on models. I am sure that there are a few questions from the audience. So please just unmute yourself and speak up or raise your hand.
Maxime, could mm-hmm. I ask you one question about your the transparency just before the conclusion, just the previous one.
This one.
You show that indeed the treatment of the H2 excitation changes the abundances of CN in the warm layer, in the top layer, quite significantly. But is it the case when you integrate the total column density through the disk? I mean, presumably, especially for HCN, most of the HCN is in the lower layer because the density of the upper layer is much lower. So is there a real impact on the column density that you would observe if you don't resolve the vertical structure?
Yeah, actually, yeah, there is a big impact. I don't have like the comparison with, but yeah, there is at least a factor of 10.
That's obvious from this one. So that's why I asked. For example, the C2H in the two, it seems to be.
So for C2H, there is not, I mean, as you can see, there is not a big impact here on the, in the inner disk. Here, yeah. There is some enhancement by a factor of five. But for CN, yeah, it's quite significant. And so, yeah, there is a factor of 10 enhancement in the column densities of CN. But still, it's so I think it can explain Tinbrew Hydra, at least that's what they have shown in causality. But they have used this thing, which this model like M2, which overestimates the valence by a factor of 10. So you may need a little bit more to explain Tinbrew Hydra, for instance.
Okay. I had another question, if nobody else is asking, which is about your deuterium chemistry. Do you take the full spin statistics from for the H3 and H3 plus and deuterated substitute?
No, so for deuterium chemistry, it's a very simple network. Okay. That so basically it's designed for HD. So there is no full. Yeah, it's for HD, and so basically HD many form through same as H2 on grain surface cable on grain, so it's H plus D basically. Mm-hmm. And then we have photodissociation of HD. So it's a pretty simple network for HD.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, are there any other questions from the audience?
Maxime? Mm-hmm. Hello, it's Valentine.
Salut, Valentine.
Salut. I have a question about HD and the excitation conditions. Mm-hmm. Are you able to propose corrections from what was derived from HD observations?
So for HD, so it was in a Tinbrew Hydra mainly, so on few other disks. And I think all those things also require modeling because you need to have like the temperature structure. So basically everything depends on what you do in your models.
That's
what we, and so for I think for HD, that's what I think, but HD is even more critical than CO because you need the temperature structure, and the temperature structure of the gas is
but for CO pretty also difficult.
CO lines are quite low. It's C18O322 is at something like 30 something K, so
yes,
there is
but
no
the...
There is no problem for the excitation.
Not for the excitation, but for the vertical
for the freeze out.
Abundance.
Yeah, for the freeze out. So
basically
what we show, so this is a paper that we are working on. So this is another slide. We show that we have tried to find the minimum model requirements to get the CO.
Okay.
Because as you know, like full models are complex, and so it's not very easy to develop. And so we find that the minimum requirement is to have a dust disk model. So basically, where you assume, so you solve for the temperature for the dust structure, and you get the dust temperature. So this kind of model, there are plenty of models like it's very similar to Chang and Goldreich, or there is also a Doulemonde model that is available online. And so then you assume like T gas equal T dust, and you need a reduced chemistry for gas and dust. And so we also come up can show that you need like something 100 chemical reactions. So that's something we are considering to make public. And so basically here I'm showing like the difference between the simple model and a more complex model. And so basically you can have less than a factor of two difference between like this very, very simple model. It takes like 2 minutes or 3 minutes to run as compared to the full model. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But yeah, you still need to have some grain surface chemistry.
How sensitive is that to the assumed disk radius?
So for C18O, that's what I showed. So that's something we have explored, because at the beginning we took like 300 AU disks. So all those models are for 300 AU disks. And then we realized that most of the disks, there is a big scatter in the Lepus survey. And so some of them are lower, are more compact. So that's why we explored like one more parameter, which is to vary the disk radius. So we took like a 100 AU disk. And you see that for C18O, it doesn't impact much. And this is because C18O mainly comes from the inner disk here. I mean, most of the emission comes from this region. It is much more critical for molecule like 12CO. You can see it here. You see that the emission varies quite a lot, or even like 13CO. But for C18O, it is like a relatively small factor, and you are still able to distinguish between different gas to dust ratio, for instance. But you always need some kind of modeling. That's the thing.
Okay, someone else has a question.
Hello, Maxime, it's Didier. Do you know that in comets you have both dust which has experienced high temperature, and you have ice? So you need some important radial mixing. Do you have enough radial mixing in your model?
So for the moment, we don't have, it's a static model. Okay. So we solve for the equilibrium structure. So there is no radial mixing. And so basically you need to have a model that, if you want to do that, you need to have some kind of evolution. So have like the structure that evolves as a function of time. But that's a model we are currently developing. Okay. So, yeah, but it's another level of...
even longer.
Yeah, so the fact is that you can't really include the kind of chemistry we have now.
Okay.
You have to reduce the chemistry quite substantially, because otherwise it becomes like impractical to run. But yeah, that's something we are currently working on.
Okay, because it might qualitatively change the composition of the disk if you have a lot of radial transport.
That's something we have to test, because based on what we see here, at least from the model at equilibrium, for instance, if you look at C/O ratios or things like that, we find that the C/O ratio is relatively well conserved. Mm-hmm. And this is because grain surface chemistry and gas phase chemistry tend to conserve the initial ratios.
Yes, it might be interesting to use very simple model to see which kind of molecule could be affected and which are not.
Yeah. But we have to be careful also with simple models, because there have been like some models that have been proposed to explain like what was found as an issue before, identified as an issue, which was the problem with CO, to reconcile HG and CO. And we find actually that this is not a problem anymore. But there were some models that have been developed to to explain this using very simple chemistry, and they could find some impact. However, it seems that the chemistry in the model is too simple, and they are missing some important processes. I have some arguments for this, but that's something we will have to test when we have like the model that treats for the evolution.
Okay, and just a remark, you have substantial differences between the simple model and what you have done. I think you should insist more quantitatively in the conclusions, because the differences are very, very large.
So in the paper, it's a paper it's been like more than a year and a half we are working on that paper, because it's very difficult to say like the work of the others is not really good. I mean, it's like, so we have to be careful about what you say. We say there is a lot of political, but anyway, we'll see how it goes.
Okay. All right. So one last question, if someone wants to speak up. Because otherwise we are at the hour now and we will conclude. So I would like to thank Maxime that you gave this very interesting seminar to us. I would also like to thank the audience that you have assisted to this. So thank you very much to all of you, and have a nice remaining evening and a nice day to Maxime.